够人数啦。
Members, we have formed a quorum. Let's start our meeting. Please invite the officials to come in. May I remind members that if you have interests related to this bill, please declare your interest. And I'll do it first. In accordance with Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure, I hold a paid job in a travel agent, and I also hold honorary posts, including the honorary president. Please refer to paper 849/16/17(07), which has been uploaded to our website. I won't introduce the officials one by one. Mr. Liu, can you please walk us through the government's response to matters raised at the last meeting? Yes, we have provided a paper setting out our response to some matters raised at the last meeting. First, the so-called time limit for proceedings of the inquiry committee. A member suggested setting a time limit on an inquiry, or when the time limit is to be exceeded, the TIA should be informed, or approval should be sought from the TIA before exceeding the time limit. As we pointed out last time, we need to set up efficient disciplinary procedures which are fair. And also, there are different procedures under clauses 98 and 99, depending on the seriousness of the case, to handle cases accordingly. An inquiry committee is required to comprise at least 3 members, and more than 1 inquiry committee can be set up to handle inquiry cases. As the nature and complexity differs in every case, and the time required would therefore vary accordingly, we consider it not suitable to set a time limit on an inquiry under the law. TIA and its disciplinary committee should be able to formulate administrative measures applicable to the cases under their handling. And we believe that this will not cause any delay. And the TIA and its disciplinary committee will regularly review the procedures, and if necessary, they would implement different measures to ensure the fair and efficient handling of all cases. And a member raised an issue about the wording of clause 117. And this is about the seeking of legal advice. Under this clause, the legal advice rendered should be disclosed to the parties, and the legal advice given before the proceedings should also be made available to all the parties. We have made reference to the other similar legislation and also past court cases. This is to ensure transparency and credibility, so that the parties in a proceeding will have access to a fair and transparent procedure. And if the legal advice given to the inquiry committee is beneficial to the transparency, and it would reduce likelihood of judicial reviews. And we have referred to a past CFA case in the footnote. Next, clause 108. is about the financial penalty, whether a repeated offender would be subject to a higher financial penalty. The inquiry committee, in deciding the penalty and the financial penalty, factors such as the nature, the seriousness, and impact of the contravention, and the conduct of the licensee after the contradiction, whether there's been any attempt to conceal the contravention, and past record of the licensee, etc. If the licensee commits the same offense, the same contravention again, this would be a factor for the inquiry committee to decide whether a heavier penalty should be imposed. But if in respect of a single contravention by a licensee, the maximum penalty that can be imposed is $300,000. And a member also asked who would write the ruling of the inquiry, who would write the disciplinary order made by the inquiry committee under clause 108, bracket 6, bracket A. If the inquiry committee makes a disciplinary order against a licensee, it must by notice in writing given to the licensee notify the licensee, and the arrangement about the writing of findings will be administratively formulated by the inquiry committee. A member at the last meeting raised a question about the effect of revocation or suspension of travel agent license. We stated that under clause 115, in the case of revocation or suspension of travel agent license, then any service any agreement, transaction, arrangement enter into any time before the revocation or suspension, and if anything has to be paid or received before the revocation or suspension, the revocation or suspension of a license will not affect such agreements or any legal liabilities. And the agreement, transaction, or arrangement here include any agreement, transaction, or arrangement enter into between a travel agent and others, including customers and service providers. Therefore, the rights, obligations, liability of any party involved will not be affected by the revocation or suspension of the license. So the parties have to honor the obligation concerned, which consider it unnecessary to add to the suggested wording that this is to protect the interests of consumers and service providers. Follow-up question, members? If not, then I want to ask a few questions. Usually, the chairman would decide whether an inquiry committee will set up, but it will be decided by the chairman. But the consumers may have expectations. If the chairman thinks that the case is not to be handled by an inquiry committee, but if the consumer or the complainant wants to hand this to the inquiry committee, is there any mechanism to appeal if the complainant wants to make a representation against the decision of a chairman, the request can be made to the TIA, or the inquiry committee. Who would make the ultimate decision? The chairman of the disciplinary committee would make the final decision, but whether the representation is given to the TIA or the disciplinary committee, they will have to handle the request in accordance with their procedures.
Why? Every year, there are many consumers and travel agents lodging different complaints, and of course, I don't agree to holding inquiries for all, but it seems that the chairman has a very high authority, so I hope that you will make the procedures very clear so that every party understands clearly what the procedures are. Another question is on point 9, that if there is a revocation or suspension of a license, travel agent's license, during the period of revocation or suspension, the travel agent still has a responsibility to fulfill the arrangement or transaction entered. So you can see from the previous case of the closed travel agency that when their license was revoked, then everything was frozen. So even if they wanted to fulfill the agreement, and so without the stamp by the travel agent, the consumers were not able to seek compensation. So that means that even though you have written this down, it's not going to be fully enforced. Thank you, Chairman. I don't think it really involves unsuccessful enforcement. Enforcement agencies have their own considerations in enforcing the law. For documents, information, if their enforcement agencies need to confiscate the information, there will still be a mechanism to return all the information and material to the involved person. It really depends on time. Not all the agreements or arrangements made would be confiscated by enforcement agencies, and as I said earlier, even if it is confiscated, it will only take some time before everything is returned to the travel agent. Well, because it involves the interest of the consumer and the travel agent. Consumers do not know what is happening, and they only want to seek compensation or try to recover their losses. But as the travel agent, feels that nothing can be done. Should the TIA come up with a set mechanism to assist those suspended travel agents to try to fulfill their obligations in the interest of consumers, so that consumers' loss would be minimized? Would this go through legislation, or it can be covered by the subsidiary legislation? Well, thank you, Chairman. We can see whether we can improve. I think we would need to go through the compensation fund, because there is such a fund that consumers can apply to, and there are procedures, and I think this should be set under subsidiary legislation. This is very important in the future when incident occurs, much like what happened in Pak Yan before. The consumers seem to be unable to do anything, so I hope that you would be able to set this clearly out. Yes, we will consider this in the subsidiary legislation. Mr. Hu Jiwei. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to ask about clause 115, or maybe I'm just not clear with the operation. It seems that when the licensed travel agent's license has been revocated or suspended, they will still need to fulfill their obligations. But the travel agent may have a relationship, may have a certain relationship with the hotels and other operators. Yes, you've listed clearly that there is an obligation, but if the license has been suspended or revoked, would normal operations be affected with the suspension of the license, and that the hotels or airlines would decide not to comply with the arrangements? I just want to make this clear. Thank you, Mr. Wu, for your question. The travel agent, of course, may have different arrangements and cooperation with other operators, but those are commercial agreements. And we would, or let's say there are some rules saying that there needs to be a license, or there are some clauses that include a license. But then clause 115 is talking about the obligations that has been entered before the revocation or suspension. And therefore, in theory, the license shouldn't really affect the arrangements. But if there are some commercial agreement that affects this kind of arrangement, then of course, no, we would consider the legal basis on that. I would like to explain a bit further. The most important point under this clause is to ensure that obligations and transactions entered into by the travel agent before the revocation and suspension could be fulfilled, and it would stop the travel agent from taking in new customers. So we did this in the interest of the public. We want to avoid any more losses by new customers and consumers. Well, Chairman, I understand the need for this clause, but then I'm not sure with the arrangements made with other operators. I understand the Deputy Commissioner saying that if there are any conflicts with on the agreements, then of course legislation would be the basis for consideration. But I'm really not clear about the operations of this industry. Maybe Chairman, you can help me on that. Maybe you can tell me that I am over concerned. That's all right. But if you say there might be such a chance that this could happen, and then the legislation would override those arrangements, that might lead to prosecution. So I am just afraid that there would be more losses suffered by the consumer. So we don't want to see an overriding right to deal with the arrangements made between operators. Let me try to explain. Usually when there is a revocation of license to a certain degree, the product supplier would immediately cut off relationship or cut off cooperation with the travel agent, because usually they would first provide the service and then ask for payment. Well, for airlines, then you might need to pay first before you get the flight tickets. But those are calculated or those are settled on a monthly basis. Oh, the travel agent, of course, would need to make sure that the customers could still get on the flights because the flights have already been paid. But if you made a reservation on a flight, yet you haven't really paid for the flight ticket, the airline would not fulfill the obligation. And then the consumer would suffer because the consumer has already paid the travel agency, yet the travel agency has not yet paid the airline. So this happens on a frequent basis. So the cooperation will be based on this, how they settle. Well, yes, so that's exactly my question. So when there is a revocation or suspension of a license, and when payment has not yet been settled, that means that the product has not yet been paid for. So can the consumer recover the loss or recover the money? All right, so we now have other members waiting to ask, so I would like to set the time limit to 5 minutes. All right, Mr. Liu, thank you. The operator and the service provider would see very clearly from this clause that arrangements entered before the revocation or suspension would be affected. So arrangements made before would be handled the same way. Let's say it's just an arrangement with the provider, then of course then it would be the same obligation or liability. But if it involves a transaction with a customer, let's say the customer joined a travel tour with full payment, then this clearly demonstrates that the travel agent has the responsibility to fulfill this obligation. Well, let's say the travel agent cannot fulfill this obligation due to financial problems or it's facing bankrupt, then under these circumstances, the consumer can go seek the compensation fund for compensation. If the travel agent has already committed to a service to the customer before the suspension of a license, then it continues to bear this responsibility even after the revocation or suspension of a license. And the consumer can also seek losses through regular procedures if the travel agent is not able to fulfill this obligation. A revocation or suspension of a license is not an excuse not to fulfill any obligation entered before the suspension of license. Well, let's say the suspension or revocation period is very long. The travel agent will be operating without a license. Am I correct? Well, thank you, Mr. Wu. This clause does not affect the transaction to take place because this has already been entered into agreement earlier. Well, because let's say if it's a tour, then the tour will still be using the flag of that travel agency. So after a revocation of the license, you still need to fulfill the obligation made before. And when you operate the tour, do you still use the tour flag of that travel agency? And does it mean that even though it's operating without a license, since it has been revoked, then it would still be acting in, under the same status as one with license?
If the license is revoked, then the agent does not have a license and it cannot take on new customers in such a state of operation. Usually there is already a loss on the arising from the revocation. Well, let's say that there's a tour which is going to start tomorrow. If today the license is suspended, so would people be surprised that this particular travel agent still organizes a tour? Because the travel agent has to keep the promise and fulfill the contract. Is that the question? Second, I'm concerned about the legal status. If this is an unlicensed travel agent and something happens, what kind of legal liabilities will be incurred? Maybe I'm worried too much, but such a scenario can actually happen. Well, it's rare. Usually when the license is revoked or suspended, the travel agent is usually about to close down, and then the compensation fund will be able to deal with the compensation. But if there are other transactions, we can consult our legal advisor on what can be done before reverting to Mr. Wu. Mr. Paul Chair, I cannot subscribe to the argument that this is rare. Let's say, if it's a tour organized by Hong Thai, should that flag be changed to a white one upon revocation or suspension of the license? And if you look at 115, if the wording is entered into any time before the revocation or suspension, or that is any agreement, transaction, etc., to enter into. But this is different from performance. Something entered into beforehand. Of course, if money is good compensation, then it's good. But you mean, I mean that enter into means that there will be performance. Is there a mechanism like the solicitors that the law society can take over the business? And you know, if there's a problem while a tour is outside Hong Kong, we have to ensure performance of the contract. So can you tell us whether enter into of an agreement covers performance?
機制考慮下剛才所提過好像法律行業有些真是接本的機制是幫到這些情況之下
And is there a takeover mechanism like the law societies so that you can take care of the parties including consumers or emergencies and then revocation take effects after you have taken care of these things? If you buy an air ticket, you may have paid already, but you haven't get the ticket. You haven't got the ticket issued to you. What if the tour is in the Middle East? How are you going to take these people back? And if the tour is to arrive in Hong Kong tomorrow, what about hotel accommodation and other things for the tourists? Why don't you do a more meticulous job in the drafting of this particular clause? And why not introduce more measures to tie in with this policy? We're talking about agreements, transactions, and arrangements entered into before the revocation or suspension. As I've stressed, we're talking about the obligation or liability under the agreement, transaction, or arrangement. We are going to seek the advice of the DOJ. I don't think this will include the organization of tours without a license. We are talking about previously agreed transactions or any agreement or transaction or arrangement entered into before revocation or suspension. We just make it clear that this particular part does not affect the rights and obligations or liability. And here we talk. We cover consumers and suppliers. Sorry. Please. Well, it's just common sense. Yes, it's just common sense. But legally speaking, you don't have to clarify this. Let's be focused. Are you going to cover performance of the contract, and how are you going to ensure that the consumer's right will not be affected? If the license is already revoked or suspended, then the continuation of the tour service as agreed may not be appropriate. Here we just talk about the liability, obligation or right will not be affected. The service provider can recover the loss, and the consumer can recover the loss through an established mechanism, so that the travel agent cannot say that the rights and the obligations and liability has disappeared because of the revocation or suspension. This question is important to the tourism industry. Please consider this thoroughly. I think we have to look at the feasibility and the legality of action. If the license is revoked while a tour is still outside Hong Kong, a tour group is still outside Hong Kong, what would happen? Please carefully consider this issue, because we need to know who should be responsible for these consumers in case of a revocation or suspension. Please ensure that this particular clause can operate effectively. Mr. Martin Lee, 112 bracket 3. Bracket 2, that no appeal is lodged within the time limit, then under bracket 3, the secretary can extend the time limit as the authority may extend the time limit. Usually this is handled by the chairman of the TIA or the chairman of the disciplinary hearing, but here the extension of time is granted by the secretary. Is that appropriate? There are two parts. The hearing will be organized by the TIA. As regards the appeal, we have to ensure its independence. You fail to understand my question. I'm talking about the appeal. I'm not talking about the entire disciplinary procedure. usually the appeal committee or the chairman of appeal committee would decide whether to grant an extension of a time. I've never seen such matters handled by the secretary. Under 112(2), if someone lodges an appeal in accordance with (1), then a notice has to be sent to the secretary within 21 days. And the secretary.
11,
I'm talking about 121. Usually the appeal is filed to the appeal committee, not to the secretary. So the arrangement is rather peculiar. Well, the appeal committee is appointed by the secretary to ensure its independence from the TIA, and therefore in terms of the period of appeal to which is the subject of an application for extension, it is going to be decided by the secretary. We'll try to find out whether there are other similar arrangements. Well, since you want to maintain the independence of the review appeal panel, the decision should be made not by the secretary, but by the appeal panel or chairman of the appeal panel. You want independence, not me. Is this a usual practice? Please check if this is the usual practice. I'm sure it's not. And also 120(1). First of all, I want to talk about the Chinese translation. It doesn't read easily. Our English consider that the removal is desirable for the panel to effectively perform its functions. The translation is rather contrived and not easy to understand. So if the removal is considered desirable, this is a subjective judgment, right? What factors will be considered? A decision can be made about the removal of any member. I will check with the law draftsman on whether we can improve the readability of certain clauses. On the question of the power to remove any member, it's of course the power of the secretary. It is not purely subjective. We'll consider whether there's a conflict of interest in the appeal panel, the extent of the conflict of interest, and whether any declaration has been made according to the law. And if there's a conflict of interest, the relevant member has failed to declare it. Then the secretary may decide to remove a member, or a member may be physically or mentally incapable of discharging the duties. Then this is the mechanism under which the secretary may remove the member. Please be succinct. Let me clarify a point. Do you have some guidelines and so on that the secretary would act in accordance with such guidelines in exercising his power? Because Otherwise, the criteria adopted by different secretaries may be different. There will be no consistency, and it may not be entirely fair.
The appeal panel would set out guidelines based on their own procedures. I'm talking about 120 bracket 1, that the secretary may remove a member of the appeal panel from office. Would you set out guidelines on that? That let's say if Mr. Porter is secretary, then there would be a set of criteria to consider that. We don't, because we're afraid that it would be unfair and partial. So do you have guidelines? Well, yes, there could be administrative guidelines and we could consider this. What you said is reasonable. I hope that you would write it down. Yeah, please submit us with additional information later on. Yes, I'm sure you have at least basic principles. Mr. Paul said, well, yes. Yes, I think what Mr. Martin Liu said, asked was very reasonable, because the term desirable is quite sloppy. So did you just decide to use any word? Because usually in other legislations it would be more specific, such as if they are mentally incapable or because they have become bankrupt, there would also be more specific reasons, because desirable is a very subjective term. Well, the deputy commissioner said they're afraid of any conflict of interest, but then we cannot I do not think that you have thought through this very thoroughly. Would there be any consequences? I hope that you would go back and really think through this very clearly. Or I don't think that you should made subjective. There should be clear guidelines. And 121 bracket 3 you were mistaken earlier that we were asking about 112. We're actually asking about clause 121. Bracket 3 said that the secretary may, in a particular case, extend the period specified in subsection bracket 2 if the secretary considers it appropriate to do so. You would not ask our chief judge or the chief justice to extend a period for a particular case, right? So have you thought about you're putting a necessary burden on the secretary, or were you just really sloppy in drafting the bill? Oh yes, although this bill is very long-winding, I hope that you would at least make it clear and not be sloppy. Mr. Liu, well, yes, on desirable, we also do reference from PMS. So we would go back and consider again for clause 121. We have always been trying to address Mr. Liu's concern. And yes, we would go back and look at how other authorities do it. Well, yes, why don't you supply us with the additional information before I follow up with more questions. All right. Well, I have a question on the inquiry arrangements. And it takes a very long time right now, at least like 9 months, or the TIA takes 9 months or even longer. Well, so from inquiry till seeing a result, I think you should set a timeline or at least a time period. But then you can now already hold an inquiry with only 3 members. So I really think that you should set a time limit from receiving the complaint till holding at least the first inquiry, you should set a time limit. Because, you know, consumers can do nothing. They complain, yet they don't think that the TIA can do anything because it takes so long. Thank you. Yes, we will consider that. Thank you. Well, if you have no other questions, we would start clause by clause scrutiny from clause 122. Mr. Liu, please. Yes, we are now at Division 2 Appeal Board. Clause 122 to clause 127 involves the appointment constitution and procedures of the appeal board. And we've already mentioned those when we were looking at inquiry. So I'll just brief you through these clauses. 122 is on appointment of appeal board. The chairperson of the appeal panel must appoint from the panel an appeal board to hear the appeal. And the appeal board is to consist of one chairperson, at least two ordinary members. And the chairperson of the panel must ensure that a majority of the members of the board are non-trade members and the members do not have a disclosable interest in the matter appealed against. Well, I do not have any concern with three members for inquiry, but then when there is an appeal, I don't think three members would be enough. So I suggest to you at least have the number remain at five. Thank you, Chairman. We have considered it very carefully. Three is the minimum number, but we have to look at it on a comprehensive basis. We hope that to give a fair and impartial inquiry to allow the defendant to appeal. We also have to balance the disciplinary mechanism. Therefore, after balancing all interests and factors, we decided on a minimum number of three members for inquiry and at least three for appeal board. But if there are any special cases, we might seek a couple more members to hold the appeal meeting. Yes, I understand that you would also seek legal advice, but and I mean three members is not a huge number. I hope that you would consider this very carefully. I'm sorry, Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you, Chairman. Three members for the appeal board, but there's also a requirement for the quorum that a majority of the members of the board are non-trade members. What if there due to different reasons there is a change of members? Would the TIA just appoint a replacement, or would there be procedures to first disperse the board and then to reappoint a whole new board? Thank you for your question. Well, in the case of any special circumstances on members, then there would be reappointment of members, or there may be an opportunity to actually to draw up a new board. But then the most important thing is to ensure that there be a fair and impartial appeal, because the appeal board might be legally challenged. And so, when appropriate, there might be the need to reappoint a whole new panel of members. So that's why we decided on the member number to be 3. Because we are also afraid that there might be circumstances affecting the board. Well, that's exactly my question. It doesn't seem to me that in writing it shows that the chairperson has the authority to reappoint new members. Or is there already a clause that deals with this problem? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Wu. Well, this also affects the procedures, which is the requirements under 123, 124, and 125. One, 124 and 125 states when there would be a quorum. For example, that there must be 3 members of the board or 1/2 of the members of the board for a quorum. Then you can, under subsidiary legislation 138, you can set up some rules. So we believe that only the quorum and the voting requirements need to be put down in the clause, and the other procedures can be set by the board. We hope that we could at any level ensure that the board could be carried out in a fair manner. So your meaning is that the appeal board need to set out the details and that they already have the authority to do so under the law. My understanding is that in future there would be subsidiary legislation for that. It would not be under this bill. Well, so one is like much like clause 124, that there must be a quorum of 3 members or 1/2 of the members of the board, and if they're not able to comply to this quorum, then they would not be able to continue to go on. And the other is that the TIA can set out some requirements. And the third level is that in 123 bracket 1, that the board can decide on the convening of the hearing of a board or the conduct of the hearing. All right, next, Mr. Martin Liu. Thank you, Chairman. I just want to go back to the supplementary information that they would provide in relation to 123. Well, in the past, you said that you need to seek the secretary's advice to extend the time limit, but I don't remember any cases. If you do have such cases, please show us. There are so many appeals, so I want you to bring out the cases, you know, so that we can compare. So you can draw reference from the AGC and the qualitative framework accreditation. I don't think that the secretary would hope to have such authority, because in the past 6 years, I have been dealing with these extensions of the cases, and then you will need to write up a decision for each case, and it's a average, you know, minimum of 6 pages or even longer. So I think if you put the verdict on the secretary, he will not welcome it at all. I mean, it is quite a strange arrangement. Thank you. Yes, we would also go and look at those references. Thank you. Mr. Tse, I would like to follow up on clause 122 on the appointment of appeal board. Mr. Lee said that bracket 2 listed the minimum number of members, that there should be one chairperson, at least two ordinary members. And under bracket 3, bracket A, a majority of the members of the board should be non-trade members. So that means there would be one chairperson, two ordinary members. So three of them would need to be non-trade, right? Because the chairperson should be a non-trade member. Am I understanding you correctly?
非業界的, 你還是要 chairperson就不同那個...
A chairperson has to be a non-trade member, but he's different from a panel chair. So are you saying that the panel chair may not be a non-trade person? The chairman of the appeal panel and the chairman, a chairperson mentioned here, can be different people. Thank you for your clarification. So the appeal chairman of the appealed board may not be a trade person, may not be a non-trade person. There's no restriction. Would all the members of the appeal board non-trade members? This is allowed under the bill. You want the majority to be non-trade members. So, and you mean that it could well be that the board comprises entirely of non-trade member. Is this the right balance? It may mean that the board has no knowledge about the trade. This is a very good question. I've been a member. And non-trade members usually do not understand how the trade works. If you don't have any trade member, there may be problems caused to the ruling. It's risky to have an appeal board comprising of all of just non-trade members. And trade members understand the malpractices even more than non-trade members. So please clarify the wording. Maybe you can provide some guiding principles on the numbers concerned. And you know that the appeal board comprises of usually three judges, sometimes two judges, and only in the CFA would there be a requirement of a minimum three judges. So please provide some numeric guidance so that we don't have a board with three members and another with 18 members. That would affect consistency and stability. Don't say that it's just 1 plus 2, and that means that the size of the board may differ very significantly from case to case. Here we want to provide the flexibility. The wording allows us to do this. Would the number be as big as 18? I think we can provide some guidance in the procedural arrangement and in the bill. We consider it more appropriate to say that it should be no fewer than two. Please tell us what your thinking is about the right number. Don't just say that this will be provided in future guideline. 123, general procedure for hearing. In this part, and also we have got some regulations make under section 138. The procedure is to be decided by the board. The hearing is to be presided over by the chairperson. 124, quorum for hearing is 3 members. If there are 3 members in the board, then every one of the board must be there to form a quorum. If there are more than 3 members, it's the half the number of members, which is the quorum. If it's an odd number or even number, then you add 1 to form a quorum. And a hearing may be conducted only if there's a majority of non-trade members. This adds some credence to my previous argument. If you have such restrictions in clause 124, then under 1241, if it's 3 members, then if you are 1 short, the hearing cannot be conducted. If you have 4 or 5, you have more flexibility. So please consider carefully how the 2 clauses can tie in with each other. Of course, it seems that there are more members, it's easier, but question of abortive meetings or hearing will also be more likely. We'll set out in the guideline on the circumstances of during which more members will be required. Well, if you have just got the minimum number of members, if some member is sick, then you would no longer have a quorum. 125, voting procedure, voting a hearing. The question is decided by majority of votes of the members present, by the majority of votes of members present, and if there is a tie, then the chairperson has a casting vote. That's in line with the usual practice. I want to clarify a point on the question of casting vote. Under 125(3), it's not about procedure. It's also about deciding the question. And it seems that the casting vote applies even in deciding the question. In an appeal court, there's no casting vote. Even if the presiding judge is in the minority, then he's in the minority, all the same. And this chairperson is a non-trade member. So is it going to be lopsided in the whole setup? Assistant Commissioner, thank you for your question, Mr. Chair. As I've said, the decision making is in line with the usual practice of committees, and we have made reference to relevant disciplinary committees. We understand the view of Mr. Chair. We'll take another look at how decisions are made by other tribunals and committees. But I would say this is the mainstream or common practice. In the final process of decision making, I don't see many chairpersons are given a casting vote. Perhaps you can give us a paper on what other panels or tribunals are doing. For example, you can look at some examples such as the appeal proceedings of insurance authority or SFC. 126, parties to appeal. The parties to an appeal are the appellant and the authority. 127, date, time, and place, and hearings. This is decided by the chairperson of the appeal board, and then a notice will be sent to the parties. This is in line with the usual practice. Please pause. Legal advisor. In respect of 127B, after the chairperson has chosen the date and of the hearing, the chairperson shall serve on the parties to the appeal a notice of the date, time, and place of the hearing. I notice that it has to be served a specified number of days before the hearing. If we look at the Property Management Services Ordinance to which the government has made reference, it's kept 626, Section 36. In respect of an appeal hearing, there's a stipulation that before 28 days before the hearing, the party should be informed. Would the government administration consider doing this so that fairness can be achieved? Thank you for your advice, dear advisor. But we would consider this to see how this can be reflected in the bill. On the fixing of the date, would there be consultation with the parties or stakeholders? Or is it just a decision made by the chairperson and there's no way the parties can seek to change it? Thank you, Chairman. The hearing of the appeal board has to be a fair and transparent, because it may be subject to further legal challenge. So the chairperson, in fixing the date, must have regard to the timetables of the parties concerned. It's just like the judiciary. They would fix a date to accommodate the parties' itineraries and timetable. If the chairperson decides a date and then one or more parties are not happy or aggrieved, the whole procedure will be subject to further legal challenge. We don't want to see this. So we hope that reasonably, the chairperson should reasonably make a decision. And the chairperson is supposed to take care of the interests of the parties concerned. Please continue. Mr. Chair, I understand your thinking, but where can we find the safeguards in the bill? Assistant Commissioner.
謝謝謝議員。基於我們剛才的考慮,我們都有提過就是說...
Due to the considerations that I've talked about, if arrangement is not made in a reasonable manner, the whole procedure will be subject to legal challenge. So we believe that the chairperson, in fixing the daytime and so on, he would take into account the needs of the parties. As I've said, clause 123, we have regulations and also to provide for the arrangements and procedures, and we can make such suitable arrangements. Well, there are so many provisos. If this happened, something else will be provided. We're talking about a long-standing mechanism. We know how courts are fixed the days of hearing. But this kind of appeal board is never in operation up to this time. if necessary, if you need something to be done, you do it. Can you tell us that there will be guidelines so that the day will be fixed under reasonable arrangement?
Mr. Lee, thank you. Well, we have committed that we would consider the legal advisors' views, and then we would see whether we could write it up more clearly, and then we would try to provide the information you require. Well, so are you going to provide us with a subsidiary legislation or more information? Yes, we are going to submit another paper next time to give you more details, so that we could use that, we could give you that for your reference. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to make something clear. Well, today we keep on talking about related guidelines and regulations and the procedures for the appeal board. Do we need to include this in the subsidiary legislation, or can we, or we not, don't have to do that? Well, usually when we're talking about procedures, regulations, we what might not see it. The appeal board would just conduct the appeal. Well, sometimes you say that you will come back with a subsidiary legislation. Sometimes you say that the board can handle it. So what is the procedure, Mr. Lee? Well, I have tried to explain that we hope to have a more comprehensive arrangement and to have enough flexibility. So when we drew up the operations of the appeal board, we would have different levels. First, to set up the number of members. Second, general procedures. But then for the details and some simple procedures, then I believe that we could allow the appeal board to handle it. So you're saying that clause 138 would become a subsidiary legislation, but then for some of the arrangements made by the appeal board, then the appeal board can decide on how to handle it themselves. Now, Mr. Wu is correct. This is our view right now. So 138 will become a subsidiary legislation, yes. And 123, the general procedures would be set by the appeal board. Yes, that is correct. So can you tell us what regulations will be made under Clause 138? Well, Mr. Wu, how about we wait till we see all these details in the next paper before we discuss it? All right. So please prepare the paper for us before the next meeting. Tell us, you know, try to make clear what we have been asking all along today. Now we move on to 128 on the proceedings of appeal board. We have also made reference with other appeal boards. This lists out the powers of the appeal board, and we hope that the power would be the same as other appeal boards. Under bracket 1 of 128, the powers are listed from bracket A to bracket H. And this includes a power to take evidence on oath, power to summon in person to attend as a witness, to give evidence, to provide information, to examine witnesses, and so on. I wanted to ensure that with these powers, the appeal board will be able to have very smooth proceedings. And so bracket 2, with the consent of the parties to the appeal, the board may determine the appeal without a hearing on the basis of written submissions only. So this is also a power given to the board. Bracket 3, if it appears to the board that the authority or the disciplinary committee has reversed the matter appealed against, the board may determine the appeal summarily in favor of the appellant without a hearing. And bracket 4 to bracket 5 gives a party to the appeal may, subject to any order made by the board, be present at the hearing and may participate in person through a legal representative or with the consent of the board through another person. And then bracket 6, to empower the board to make an order as to the payment of the costs and expenses incurred in relation to the hearing. So this is what clause 128 is. Legal advisor. Thank you, Chairman. On clause 128, section 2 and 3, it says that with the consent of the parties to the appeal, the board may determine the appeal without a hearing on the basis of written submissions only. So would the proceedings be the same as the inquiry? So how about the quorum or the proceed or the voting of the board? Or where can you see that? Well, we looked at section 51133F under the EAA ordinance. So we had listed out that the quorum should be minimum number of 3, and that the majority of the members should be should agree to make a decision. So are you basing this on 124, 125, and 126, these three clauses? Mr. Lee, yes, clause 123, 125, and 126 are part of the bill, and of course you would need to comply with the bill. And in clause 128, there are also other powers for the appeal board, and you would also need to comply with those requirements. Okay, if not, other questions? Sorry, please wait, Mr. Paul. Well, can the legal advisor finish asking the question? Well, if that's the case, because you mentioned clause 123, 24, and 125, that's for the hearing. But then in clause 128, bracket 1, the powers are also for the hearing. So if under bracket 2, bracket 3, if some decisions have been made without a hearing and members just use written submissions only to determine the appeal, then where would the powers lie? Because if you look at clause 128, bracket 1, this is the power that of an appeal board when hearing an appeal. And that is actually not applicable to bracket 2 and bracket 3. Well, thank you for your observation. It seems that we are not being clear enough. We would try to improve the writing here so that whether it be hearing or appeal, it would be come a smoother procedure. All right, so please apply us with that later on. Mr. Paul said, the legal advisor actually asked the question I wanted to ask. Now I'd like to ask another question. 128, bracket 4, Roman numeral 3. So you said a party to the appeal may participate with the consent of the board through another person. So what is this other another person? Are you trying to be more relaxed that it could be any person other than a lawyer or someone from the travel agency? So, for example, can I just ask Mr. Yu Siwing to go instead? No, thank you, Mr. Tse, for your question. Well, we hope that the appeal side, when they feel that the decision made, when they're aggrieved by the decision made by the TIA and by the hearing, then they can lodge an appeal. Well, so under Roman numeral 3, with the consent of the board, another person can also participate in the appeal. And this is now similar to what is done at the TIC. But of course, it is up to the needs of the appellant. Mr. Tse, it seems that other industries are not so relaxed with who can attend the appeal. What are the considerations of whether you allow a person to participate? Well, I mean, of course, you know, if I ask Mr. Yu Siwing to attend for me, then of course, you know, it would be beneficial to me because he is well known in this industry. So can you tell us what your considerations are? Are there any limitations and restrictions? Or maybe you can supply us with this information at the next meeting. Thank you, Mr. Tse. We are not the only one coming up with this clause. We have also looked at clause 37, bracket 7 under PMS ordinance. So we think that this is appropriate as well. So when would the board allow a third party to attend? It really depends on the individual circumstances. We understand that the appellant may really be unavailable during the appeal or because of other reasons could not attend the appeal meeting. We don't have an example to show you right now, but we believe that the appeal board can act as a gatekeeper to decide whether another person can attend and make the relevant requirements. Oh yes, I understand, but my concern is that if you look at other bills for security, maybe it's different, but if at the travel industry, the appellants in the travel industry, you know, they may be from very small travel agencies, they may seek assistance. But have you considered why you need to do so? I think you really should go back and reconsider whether there really is a need to allow another person to participate with a consent of the board. We have to understand what deciding factors are. Thank you, Mr. Tse. Well, we will provide you with supplementary information. All right, next, Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you, Chairman. I have a question because I see that the term used is participate. So what is the concept behind using the term participate? It seems that they're allowed to attend, so I can invite other people to represent me to attend the meeting. But would those people be representing me? Mr. Lee, thank you, Mr. Wu, for your question. Our intention by using the term participate is to attend a a hearing, and because you have to look at 4 bracket A and B together. 4 bracket B use the term may participate. So these people may participate in the hearing. That means attend the hearing. So the appellant can find a legal representative to attend, to give proxy, or to find a proxy, or to attend in person. Am I correct? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Wu. The person can attend in person or through a legal representative. If he wants to find someone, not himself or not the legal representative, to attend, then he needs to seek the consent of the board. And Mr. Tse has already requested further information on this. Thank you.
Let me clarify this point. Is this term used in other proceedings? Mr. Lee, thank you for your question. When we prepared this part, we have made reference to CAP 626, a Property Management Services Ordinance. We have borrowed some term from that ordinance. Please don't mind that we are picking on the wording. Because if we do it here, other bills will also borrow the same term in this bill. Well, participate is not about representing anyone or right of audience. If you represent a client, then whatever you say that counts. Participate can be for different reasons. You can be just there in attendance, or you may be a legal representative. And also this participation by a third party has to be subject to the agreement of the board. So it should be something serious. Maybe you can use some term which is more precise. Instead of copying this from the EAA ordinance or PMS ordinance, maybe you should do away with the word participate. A party may attend personally or may do it through a legal representative. We would talk to our law judgment to see how we can improve the wording if necessary. All right, please provide the supplementary information required next time. 129. The appeal board may issue a summons under section 128, bracket 1, bracket B. And this clause is about the form. It must be in the specified form, it must be signed by the chairperson, and it must specify the requirements that the person must comply with. Mr. Paul Chair, I want to say something about 128 bracket 6. The board make an order as to the payment of the costs and expenses incurred. Is this legal equivalent to legal costs incurred by hiring a solicitor or a barrister? Does this cover the legal costs in the sense of a litigation? Well, yes, this is in line with our understanding. The board may make an order as to the payment of costs and expenses. If the sum is astronomical, it's not as simple as the traveling allowance for a witness to attend the hearing in for 2 days. Can the board just plug a figure out of thin air, or would you be providing some guidance to the board on how to calculate the cost? Can that be clearer delineation of what course can be covered. Actually, we have made reference to other ordinances and the wording there. Of course, we are happy to consider whether it can be improved. Well, I think you are abusing the reference process. The composition of different appeal boards can be very different, and the level of participation of the members can be very different. And those ordinances might not have been subject to very careful scrutiny before passage. Perhaps you should provide some clear guidance, or you may stipulate that the board should have regard to the guidelines and principles adopted by the course in awarding course. Please provide some guidelines. Otherwise, it can be very subjective, and it can be very inconsistent. Mr. Martin and Neil, I want to follow up the question raised by Mr. Chair. Well, if you cover costs of lawyers, sometimes the cost can be taxed by a master of the court. I don't know whether the court will welcome this in this bill, but in some cases the costs are to be taxed by a master. But this, because this is rather professional, whether certain costs should be allowed or not allowed is a professional matter. Second, how can you enforce this? Because the offense doesn't include one that says it's a failure to comply with the cost of order. If I lose a case and I incur, say, I'm awarded a, I'm asked to pay $50,000 in cost and I do not comply, who's to enforce the order? So I think Mr. Chair is correct. You need to have system to enforce this. You cannot just copy something from another law. Mr. Lee, thank you, Mr. Liu, for your question. Mr. Liu suggests whether we can make reference to the taxation of costs of the cost. We would go back and take an order. As regards this order, what if it's not complied with? Under in the clause 169, such a order will be enforced as civil debt, and the enforcement can be done by going to submitting an application to the court. It's a 169C. Any costs and expenses order to be paid under section 128 bracket 6. So it can be recovered as a civil debt.
主席有两点的，第一个咧就
Mr. Wu Chi-wai. There can be legal representatives attending the hearing. Are there major legal points involved in the hearing? Why don't you do away with legal representations for the hearing? That's possibility number one. Second possibility,
是就住一個法律訴訟裏面有啲基本嘅法律費用係定定咗。Would
you be ready to set certain limits to the cost? Then, if not, then I think the parties which are rich will enjoy a lot of advantage over a weaker side. Of course, the subject of the appeal is the order of the TIA, and the TIA is, of course, the stronger party. So where do you draw the line for a proper balance? So that's second point. The first point I want to make. And what if there's a dispute as to costs? Would the appeal board handle this argument? Or is this a order, the final order? Mr. Lee, thank you, Mr. Wu, for your questions. This is an appeal mechanism. We need to afford better protection to the appellant. So one of the protection is that he's entitled to legal representation. He can choose not to, but if he can have a legal representation, so that his views can be expressed more fully, then he's allowed to do this. As to whether there's a limit, whether there should be a limit to cost. We have made reference to the current mechanism under the TIA and also the EAA, the procedure and past experience. We don't see a clear case of setting a limit because of a huge cost. And if we are to set a cost limit, this may affect the transparency and fairness of the proceeding. And as a result, the procedure may be subject to further legal challenge. And what if the cost cannot be agreed to, and that's a dispute? The appeal board is empowered here to make an order if there's a further legal challenge. If a party involved in a appeal procedure under a tribunal or appeal board, then he is entitled to challenge this in the court, but this will be outside the ambit of the bill. Chairman, at present, the appeals are handled by the TIA. Can we be given some reference information? We need to make a judgment based on the characteristics of this trade and their operations. So we need to get information on the state of affairs of the EIA and other licensing authorities in handling appeals. Can we be given some reference information? Please provide the data. We cannot really provide information on different practices. So I'm concerned that the stronger side may bully the weaker side. Maybe we can be given some information on the cost in case of legal representation. It's about 10:30, so let's do it next time. The next meeting will be held on the 4th of June. It's a Monday. We start at 4:30 p.m. Please attend that meeting accordingly. There's nothing under the AOB. Meeting's adjourned.